Welcome to our virtual church on this Remembrance Sunday. We had that rousing introduction with that old band march entitled Under Two Flags. And many of us will remember from the Boundless Congress, this being played with the Joint Salvation Army military bands from Nella Hall, the home of military army music. When you hear the music, you can hear snippets of Rule Britannia and God Save the King, as was written by Bramwell Coles at the end of the First World War, as a salute to the Salvationists who were and who have served in the British services. Many Salvationists over the years have served their country in their armed forces. Also many, like myself, in the various different bands performing at public and ceremonial events. Yet also being able to deploy in our secondary role as stretcher bearers or medics. I recall when the regiment that I was in was told that it was going to war and the band was staying behind. Everybody was happy. The regiment was happy because they were going to do what they wanted to do. They weren't going to go and fight. And the band was happy because we weren't going to go. We joined the army, we joined the military to make music. But I also remember a week later, the commanding officer got the regiment together and said, I've got some really bad news, but also a little bit of good news. The bad news was the regiment was not going to war. They were absolutely gutted, grown men almost in tears. But he said the good news is that the band are going as medics. And as you can imagine, the band at the time was not overly chuffed. We had a weekend off and then an intense week of all things army, then off to Saudi Arabia for what became 6 long months which encompassed the war. Oh, and we took our instruments with us, so we had to make sure that we practiced. We were the weapons of mass destruction, playing our instruments in the middle of the desert. Yet this was a physical war, and today Salvationists and Christians were engaged in an even more deadly war, a spiritual war. And this is the reality that Robert Johnson really knew when he took a drinking song, "Here's to good old whiskey, drink it down," and washed it in the colours of Salvationism, washed it in the blood of the Lamb. Soldiers of God, arise, the day is drawing nearer. Shake the slumber from your eyes, the light is growing clearer. Sit no longer idly by while the heedless millions die. Lift the bloodstained banner high and take the field for Jesus. Storm the force of darkness, bring them down, bring them down. It's our first song this morning on this Remembrance Sunday. So wherever you are, I encourage you to sing as loud as you can so all your neighbours can hear you enjoying worship. Let's sing together, shall we, friends? Thank you. great song of praise and worship to get you going into action. Yet at times we also need to be still. You know, when you can smell gunpowder, when you look at the sky and see missiles flying overhead, when you can hear the rumble of explosions and see in the far distance that constant glow from battle, your prayer life improves. Yet it shouldn't. We should be willing and happy to come to God when things go well as in the difficult times. The secret to all success in life is prayer. We need to remember, as the song says, to whisper prayer in the morning, whisper prayer at noon, whisper prayer in the evening, and keep your hearts in tune. Because as the song continues, God answers prayer. My prayer is summed up in the chorus of this song, that God's Spirit will come and pour on us right now here today. Let's sing together the song, Great is the Darkness.
Great is the darkness that covers the earth. Oppression, injustice, and pain. Nations are slipping in hopeless despair.
Lord Jesus.
Shall we pray, friends? Father God, on this day, we remember those who have given their lives that we can enjoy the freedom and liberties that we have today. We also remember those who went to war and simply didn't come back. We think of the families that have been affected. We think of the effect that this has had on our world. And Lord, we give thanks and we are grateful for that. But we also thank you, Lord, for sending us Jesus, that we could have that possibility of being restored to eternal life with you. So Father God, as we continue with our service today, be with us, bless us, and use us. This we ask in your dear Son's name. Amen.
Morning everyone. We're nearly there, day six of creation story. And our box is getting fuller now. So last week we were thinking about the birds and the fish. And so I'm just gonna put my fish in the box. Because remember in the very beginning, when the earth was empty, it wasn't meant to be that way. So that's why God went and created all the wonderful things that we have, including animals and humans, our friends, our family members, those people that we really love and that we're close to. And I have a friend who I get on really well with, despite the fact that we're two completely different people. We met on my counselling course, so that we have that in common, but apart from that, you wouldn't match us together as being friends. We're just so different. And I absolutely love that because we have all been created in such a unique way, haven't we? It could get a bit boring to only spend time with people who were just like you. What would you learn? How would you grow? How would you witness about God to people? And humans weren't designed to be alone all of the time. God gave us each other, all completely different and special. And how much richer and fuller are our lives for having other people in them? Whether that's those we live with, those we talk to on our phones, people who visit us, and therefore how much richer and fuller is our world for being full of all these humans that are made in God's image. And we know that not all of us act in ways that God would like us to. In fact, we all fall short. As I've said in previous things that I've said, there's always the opportunity to be more like God and Jesus. Always, there's always opportunity. It's never too late. A while ago, I introduced a few songs by the Army Worship Band Transmission. and here they are again singing their version of To Be Like Jesus. It's very reflective, and I hope that you can gain something from the lyrics of this song and consider just how you can be like Jesus.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rachel, for your thought and continuing with the creation theme, and also for introducing us again to the Sawishnami Worship Group transmission. So now we move on, and we have the band have put together this message to us with some very moving visuals. So thank you, and here we'll listen to the message from the band. Thank you. I invite you to stand while we remember before God the men and women of all nations who have died as a result of war. Those we have known and those whose memory we treasure. Those we never knew and those who have died unknown. We remember all that have lived in hope and died in vain. The tortured, the innocent, the starving and the exiled, the imprisoned, the oppressed and the disappeared. Also, it's fitting that we remember the victims of the many terrorist tragedies over the years and the conflicts that are raging today.
They shall grow not old,
as we that are left grow old.
It shall not weary them, nor the years condemn.
At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
When you go home,
tell them of us and say,
for your tomorrow, we give our today.
Remembrance is so important so that we do not repeat the mistakes of the past. If politicians of both sides do their job and talk and reach compromise, then this world will be a better place. If we as a population refuse to get dragged down to a one-side nationalistic approach and ask the simple question, what would Jesus do? Then this world would be a much better place. If we showed love, such love that is so amazing, and this love of God is pure as the whitest snow. So let's reflect as we sing.
The song for this morning is American publication, People Need the Lord, sung by Pasadena Tabernacle Songsters.
Thank you.
Today here on this Remembrance Sunday, we need to remember the lessons from the past, the sacrifices given by so many for us. We need to remember, we should remember, yet dare I also say, we need to change. Change is not a popular word, and indeed with the introduction of yet more restrictions to our lives, how different are we living today from what we were a year ago? Change is a painful word, yet a word that we're all called to do as Christians. Therefore, if anyone was in Christ, it's new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. It may not say the word change, but it means change. Once we've been changed in this new creation, we need to continue to keep changing and working on perfecting this change. Today, millions of people will remember the past sacrifices and the change that has been hard fought and won to allow us to enjoy the freedom, or not so much freedom, as we experience today. But if we fail to change as human beings, then World War II and all the other wars would have been for nothing, and we have learned nothing. Many of us can remember people from our youth saying, oh, remember during the war, or I remember when. Nathaniel, some years ago, asked me what apartheid was, having never grown up and listened to the news or seen the injustices of that system. Just as in 20 years from now, youngsters will be asking, so what was life like under lockdown? We must remember, we need to remember and remind our children, and sometimes ourselves, yet continue to live. Otherwise, the world that we would live in, the society we would live in, would be unable to move on. We need to look forward and change. Change our outlook, change our expectations. And as we have recently, in the last few months, change how we do church, moving from the physical to the virtual realm. I firmly believe that if we as a church stay faithful and concentrate on the main thing, our calling as Christians to preach the gospel, which occasionally means talking, to preach the gospel through our actions, to seek to grow in grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. If we continue to study scripture and continue to pray, then God will be faithful and take care of all the other stuff. Remember, we as Christians were not called to fix the world's problems. And I think that sometimes can be a Christian problem. We try to fix everything. But rather, we're to show Christ, to make disciples of all nations and cultures. We must never get so busy doing that we fail to be. I remember John Gowans, when he was Territorial Commander, came to college and there was a question and answer session. And I asked John Gowans, did he think that the Salvation Army of that day was mission or maintenance focused? And John Gowans was clever in his answer. He said some of the Salvation Army is mission focused and really going about and impacting their local communities, which is great. He said some of them are maintenance focused, struggling to maintain what they have. But he said also, sadly, there's another element, some are museum pieces, clinging on to what was for the sake of clinging on to what was. All dead, but yet in the name of. And that is not good. We as a Salvation Army must be mission focused, looking to our communities. And how can we portray Jesus Christ in everything we do? We must be faithful to our calling from God, our commitment to God, and also our covenant with God. If we fail to change, we become more and more less God's people, and will become more and more bitter and twisted with a singular vision of what we believe is right. It has got nothing to do with God, and nothing will change it. When Jesus came to earth, he challenged the very core of Jewish society. You see, they had the law written in the Torah, and you can find that in the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. The law was black and white. You could do this, and you couldn't do that. The law dictated your every move. Yet Jesus said, as recorded in Matthew's gospel, you've heard the law say, the punishment must match the injury, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say, do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you on the right cheek, offer the other cheek also. If you are sued in court for your shirt is taken from you, give your coat too. If a soldier demands you to carry a cross for him, carry it 2 miles. Give to those who ask, and do not turn away from those who want to borrow. The law dictated limited retaliation, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. Yet Jesus said, turn the other cheek. He said, if they want to take your shirt, give me a coat also. If they ask you to carry something for the maximum distance under the law of 1 mile, do it for two. That's where we get the saying of go for the extra mile. Jesus turned this everyday black and white thinking upside down. And St. Paul beautifully expands on this thinking when he, at the end of 1 Corinthians 12, when he says, and now let me show you a more excellent way. And we know that that is a way of love. Jesus told us to love our enemy, to turn the other cheek, to reject limited retaliation, and that was allowed by the law. For you and me, for every Christian who's ever lived, we are to show love. A great example of this Christian principle is shown to Germany after the war. We helped to rebuild. We helped our former enemy. If somebody said to you in 1944 that the iconic British motor car, the Mini, would be owned by a German company, or indeed that people would look at German and Japanese cars as being extremely popular within the United Kingdom, or even having large factories here, you would have thought, well, they would have thought that you'd gone absolutely bonkers. Yet because of changed attitude and outlooks, because we have helped and showed forgiveness, this has become possible. The recent pandemic, which we were all affected by, shows how much this world is interdependent. St. Paul says in Scripture, slaves, obey your earthly masters with deep respect and fear. Serve them with sincerity as you would serve Christ. Try to please them in all the time, not just when they're watching you. As slaves of Christ, do the will of God with all your heart. Work with enthusiasm, as though you were working for the Lord rather than for the people. Remember that the Lord will reward each one of you for the good work you do, whether you are slaves or free. Are we saying, if we take this literally, that Christian viewpoint is pro-slavery? No, of course not. Changed circumstances offered a changed viewpoint, but with the same scriptural truth applied today. Would be simply this, employees, be the best you can for your employer. And the reason for doing this is that you do such a good job that your employer, instead of chasing you, says, wow, what is different about you? And that difference is that you become a Christian. You know Christ and you live Christ's truth within your life. The might of the Roman Empire, the armies had failed to conquer, was changed by salt. Simple acts of love and trust. We as Christians are called to be salt and light to the world, to show and make a difference, to be countercultural or even radical. Let me give you this illustration of this. Roman families wanted only boys. Boys could work, they were strong, they could help the family grow stronger and richer. Girls cost the family money. So the not so well off Roman families would, upon having a baby girl, take them to the local rubbish dump and dump them, abandoning them there. The earlier Christians found this out and went and rescued them, scooping them from the rubbish dips and bringing them up as their own. You have to remember that the early Christians were very, very poor, yet they gave from their poverty and the world changed. Just as we remember those who have given their lives for the freedom to allow us to live our lives and enjoy our freedom, we must also remember to pay tribute to them. We also remember the many Christians who have been killed for no other reason than simply being a Christian. We're reminded those Christians who are being persecuted for their faith, unable to defend themselves, not just now, but throughout the centuries. We need to bring in a culture of change, a change of tolerance, a change that shows God's love in the same way those early Christians changed a ruthless empire to become what became the Holy Roman Empire. Perhaps we need to be risk takers, actively praying for people and family members with a new zeal, praying big and believing big. Remember, the Bible tells us with God, all things are possible. How big is your vision for the Monkwearmouth call? What is God challenging you with today? Remember the past? Yes, but look forward to the future. The best days of us, the Salvation Army, for this call are certainly ahead of us. I truly believe that. It would be easy to say, perhaps even what's the point, and just go with the flow, not to rock the boat. And many have done that, yet a ragtag band of converted drunks 150 years ago transformed the society and the world of today. They were radical. They were merely uneducated, had some amazing characters, but they were God's army of salvation, and we are the result. We are as what the church needs to be. We need to be listening to God and saying, in my life, Lord, may your will be done. May your will be done in my life. May you have all there is of me and leave the rest to God and enjoy the ride. The journey will be amazing. Do we say it can't be done? What's the point? Or do we say, Lord, let your will be done? Jesus said that you're blessed people. Listen to a few words from the Message paraphrase. You're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God in his rule. You're blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Only then can be embraced by the one who is most dear to you. You're blessed when you're content with just who you are. No more, no less. That's the moment you find yourself proud owners of everything that can't be bought. You're blessed when you worked up a good appetite for God. His food and drink is the best meal you can ever eat. You're blessed when you care. At the moment of being careful, you find yourself cared for. You're blessed when you get your inside world right, your heart and your mind. Then you can see God in the outside world. You're blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and God's plan. You're blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. The persecution drives you even deep into God's kingdom. Not only that, count yourself blessed every time you're put down or thrown out, or people speak lies about you to discredit me. What it means is the truth is too close for comfort and they're uncomfortable. You can be glad when this happens. Give a cheer, for they don't like it. I do. And all heaven applauds. And you know you're in good company. My prophets and witnesses have gotten into all that kind of trouble. Friends, do you feel blessed? Because you are blessed. Will you allow Jesus to bless others through your actions? Be the salt and light in this world. And I pray that you will show and continue to show simple acts of love and trust to all those you meet, because you're a blessed people and you can be a blessing to others through God working through you. Thank you for saving me. What can I say? As you reflect on the words that have been shared today, on this Remembrance Sunday, listen to this song and say thank you to God for saving you.
Thank you for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything. I will sing your praise. You shed your blood for me. What can I say? You took my sin and shame, a sinner called by name. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. For we know your truth and grace are mine, forgiven is my sin. Jesus, my only hope, the Savior of the world. Great is the Lord, we cry, God, let your kingdom come. Your word you for saving me. Yeah.
Thank you for joining with us on this Remembrance Sunday. I hope that you've been blessed and challenged by this meeting, but also that you're willing to change and allow God to change you even more, to become the person, like we pray that this call will become the call that God wants us to be. We're going to conclude our worship just now by singing a fabulous song entitled Peace in Our Time, O Lord. But before we sing that, let me pronounce a word of benediction, then we can sing in conclusion. Let's pray, shall we? Father God, we thank you for today. We thank you that we've been able to meet virtually. We thank you that we've been able to meet, for some, across countries, from Spain to Scotland, from Wales to England, even to South Africa. And Lord, we just thank you that we can meet as brothers and sisters in Christ, and that you will bless us. Help us to remember the sacrifices of the past, but also, Lord, help us to look forward with excitement to what you've got in store for us as a church, as a Salvation Army. And Lord, in our lives, in this court, in your Salvation Army, we pray that your will be done, now and forever. Amen and amen. So friends, let's sing in conclusion, shall we? Peace in our time, O Lord.